You ready, champ?
I've been ready for this my whole life.
Starting defense! Place at the table!
Let me see those hands again! Yeah. Hey, on the high. Hey, everybody jump.
Welcome to Holding the Edge, sponsored by DC1. Holding the Edge is designed to gain insights into how coaches are not only holding the defensive edge, but the competitive edge as well.
On Holding the Edge, we are honored to be joined by Coach Chris Vaughn. Coach Vaughn joined the Dallas Cowboys in 2017, and he is the team's Southeast Area Scout. He came to the Cowboys personnel department with 18 years of collegiate coaching experience. Most recently, he was in Austin for two seasons at the University of Texas. He coached the defensive backs there while also serving as the school's special team coordinator. Before Austin, he was coaching the cornerbacks in Memphis for two seasons. And after spending four seasons as the defensive back coach and recruiting coordinator at Ole Miss, Coach Vaughn was at Arkansas for 8 years, and he coached linebackers, safeties, cornerbacks, and he also served as the director of on-campus recruiting. He had a brief stint in Tulsa, and that was his first coaching job, after serving as a GA in Arkansas in 1999. Coach Vaughn earned four letters as a linebacker at Murray State. He won the Ohio Valley Conference title in 1995 and 1996. He is a native of Tallahassee, Florida. Vaughn and his wife, Marquette, have a son, Chris II, and two daughters, Cienna and Camryn. Welcome, Coach Vaughn.
Thank you very much, Jeff. Glad to be on.
Well, I'm really glad you're here. I appreciate it. So when did you first realize you wanted to be a coach and make that your profession?
Well, it's kind of funny, the story. I did not grow up playing organized sports, until I didn't play football until the ninth grade. You know, played some pickup in the yard when I was young, but never put on a pair of pads or a helmet until the ninth grade. And, had some buddies. I was kind of a nerd growing up, but, you know, had a buddy of mine said, hey, let's go try out for the football team. So we go to the JV football tryout and I actually make the team and my buddy doesn't. And of course that kind of splintered our relationship, because once you start playing, you know, athletics and you're going and lifting weights and going, you know, the life of an athlete is different than the normal student. Not better, not worse, just different. Ninth grade, I'm 5'10 and a half, 185. I'm playing offensive tackle and defensive tackle in the ninth grade. And it was funny, the first time I ever put pads on, I needed somebody to help me because I didn't know where everything went. You know, again, I'm in ninth grade, never played peewee, never played, youth football. So I got help, put my pads in, and after ninth grade, moved up to varsity, did well, moved up to varsity, and I was a three-year letterman on varsity, two-and-a-half-year starter. On varsity, but fell in love with the game in the ninth grade. You know, it was kind of new, had kind of built my confidence. All of a sudden, I kind of went from a guy that was kind of in the back of the room to, you know, this guy that was, you know, playing football and, you know, doing well. And, you know, so it really changed my life. And I think the other reason I knew I wanted to be a football coach was because of my relationship with the college coaches and with the high school coaches that I was dealing with at the time. Had a great relationship with my head coach, really, really close with him and his son. His son is one of my really good friends, and he was the quarterback. And when I left for college, I knew I wanted to be a coach. I thought I wanted to be a high school coach because of the relationship you could have with your players. From what I had always heard, you could, you know, that was the only place you could have a relationship like that is at the high school level. In college, it's a business. Well, I get to college and I meet my college coach, Houston Nutt, and their staff, and I learned that you could have the same type of relationship on the college level as you did with at the high school level, and the pay is a little bit better. Stability is not as good according to where you're coaching at, but and the hours are a little bit different. But fell in love with the opportunity to coach in college, and Coach Nutt left Murray State after my sophomore year to go be the head coach at Boise State. And then he was the head coach at Arkansas my senior year. And he knew my aspirations to be a football coach. And he thought I'd be a good one. So called him up and asked for a GA spot, and he had one waiting for me. And then that's kind of how things got started.
So you've coached college football. You've trained high school football players and athletes. You're now in the NFL. What are the biggest differences between communicating with the players at the various levels? You talked about in college, you know, the misnomer maybe is it's always a business. But what are the differences with communicating with all those different levels?
Well, you know, definitely in high school and college, there's a respect level between the coaches and the players. That's just kind of unsaid. You know, he's the coach. I'm the player. In the NFL, it's a little bit different. There's still a respect level there, but it's more of a partnership more than it is in the high school and college level. And I think that's important that guys know that dynamic just because athletes are changing and times are changing. And I think the most successful NFL guys right now, and I think that's why you see a trend of the young guys getting the jobs right now because they can relate to the players. It's not the old school mentality, which, you know, I think has influenced a lot of that. One thing about it is that you can't knock experience. So there's still always the old wise guy that's been coaching for, you know, 40 years, a la Wade Phillips, you know, that's coaching in the Super Bowl this weekend. But you've got Wade Phillips, and then you've got Sean McVay, who's this young guy that, you know, does a great job relating to all the players. But then you've got a guy like Wade Phillips that's been there, done that, there for the experience. So I think the biggest difference is the dynamic in the relationship. You don't deal with them the same way. And for a lot of it, you don't have to because these are professionals now and this is their job. You know, of course, everybody gets tired. So you have to say, hey, let's go, let's pick up practice. But for the most part, those guys know, hey, I get paid to come practice football and then play. And then, of course, instead of saying playing time, there's fines, there's ways to get things going with NFL players based on fines and problems like that, where that affects their way of life just because that's the way they make their living. So it's a different dynamic. I think the love of the game starts to, and the business aspect starts to kind of come into it the higher up you go. Because it is still a business when it gets going, and but those are probably the differences in those levels of football.
You mentioned Wade Phillips, defensive coordinator of the Rams, going to be in the Super Bowl 53 this weekend. You've always been a coach that's been on the defensive side of the ball,
right?
If you took a DC job today, and I'm not saying you're looking for DC jobs, but if you just took a DC job today, what are the tenets of your philosophy and what you've seen from the coaches you've worked with and the things you've implemented on different teams?
Well, I think fundamentally there's a couple things. I think that you've got to get guys. The thing about coaching in general is getting talented young people to do things that they don't always want to do, get them to believe in something that they're not sure of. You know, you've got to sell to them that this blitz is going to work on third down. You know, how do you know? Because, you know, I'm selling it to you. If we do this and we do that, things should work out. And getting those guys to believe it and go run at 100 miles per hour and believe in it is something that I think you've got to be able to do. And people do that in different ways because people have different personalities. But I think that's important, is that you get a belief and there's something that you can hang your hat on as a defense, whether it be, you know, I know when I first started off in coaching, one thing that we always believed in was, you know, there was a certain call that our defense coordinator made. And anytime he made that call, the whole defense just felt like it was going to be a big play and it was going to work. The magic wasn't in the call. The magic was in the belief in the call. Because there's, you know, it was Eagle front, you know, sending a wheel linebacker through the A gap, and bringing pressure off the edge in a Eagle front and a bear front, and, you know, playing zero coverage, but it's the belief in the call, that made the difference. It wasn't the call. So I think that's very important. I think that's, you know, and whether it be that call or whether it be, you know, the way you stop the run, or we're really good in pass defense, or we're really good at blitz, whatever you're really good at, I think you got to do a great job of selling it and having your guys believe in it. I think playing hard and getting guys to play hard is imperative. I mean, you can have the best call drawn up, but the other guys get, you know, we say in NFL get paid, or if you're in college, they're on scholarship, or, you know, if you're in high school, the other guy's trying to, you know, play well on Friday night too. And you know, the coaches are paid to coach well on Friday night too. But effort, you know, can cover up a lot of things. And I think if you play with, and that's your calling card in your resume. When you turn on the tape, you know, do your guys play hard? And can you get your guys to play hard? And I've been around some coaches that were great at still instilling those things. You might not always win every game, but man, as a coach, if you lose one or if you win one, there's nothing like, you know, a coach come to you and say, your guys play hard. There's nobody else, you know, that we've played this year that played as hard as your kids. So I think coaching effort, coaching, you know, belief in the system that you're running. And I think nowadays, the thing that's a little bit different, Jeff, is that I think it's very hard to coach defense these days because of what the offenses are doing. And I think you kind of have to mimic that a little bit as a coach now. I think you've got to be a little bit more on the offensive, you know, and try to make some things happen as opposed to, you know, the bend and don't break, you know, that's never been my philosophy, but now more than ever, I think it's just too hard to be a bend and don't break defense with the way offenses are attacking people and playing these days. I think you got to create lost yardage plays. I think you got to create turnovers. You can't wait for them to happen. You got to go create them. And when that happens, you might give up a couple, but you got to give up a couple to make a couple and keep the offense a little off balance.
So we know offenses have the advantage a lot of the time that we deal with from the defensive side of the ball. So this is an unfair question, and I will preface it by saying this is unfair. So let's talk secondary coverage.
Okay.
You only have one coverage you can do, and that's it. Yep. You can't get out of it. You have to stick in it no matter what. And it doesn't matter what the, you know, and this is, again, an impossible question to answer. What's your favorite coverage and why?
Man-free.
Okay.
I really like man-free. Now, I have to preface that with saying, if you have guys that can play man, mm-hmm. and if you are getting a pass rush, but there's no gray area. He either catches it or he doesn't. And I like zone coverage in situations, and there's certain situations where zone coverage is needed. But you know, the one thing I loved about coaching man coverage is, like I said, there's no gray area there. It is, you know, he either caught it or he didn't. And you kind of work that mindset into your players. Now, with that being said, there's going to be times where guys make a great catch. And when they do, and you're in tight coverage and they make a great catch, hey, man, I'm one of the first guys to say, hey, that guy's on scholarship too, or that guy's a pretty good player too. They just made a play, move on to the next one. But dealing with defensive backs is different. You know, it's different than any other position I've ever coached because of the mindset. You know, you want them to be cocky. You want them to be confident. You know, people have told me before, you know, you worry about your guys being too cocky or too confident. And as a defensive back coach, I never did because, one or two things were going to happen. If they were really cocky and really confident, if they weren't that good, that was going to be exposed. And if they were, it just kept growing. So it usually took care of itself. I've told defensive backs that I've coached before that it's the rock star position of the defense. It's coaching corners, especially. There's no other position in football like corner, in my opinion. And the reason I say that is because, you know, if a DN gets hurt, we might take a linebacker and say, hey, put him on the edge and just rush him right now. Or if a deep tackle gets hurt, hey, just take the DN for a couple plays. Let's put him down in a three technique and just tell him to jet up the field. If a linebacker gets hurt, let's take the safety. And, you know, let's drop him down, let's cover him up, put him behind a three technique, let him run to the ball, let him be a hidden linebacker, we'll be okay. If a safety gets hurt, let's take one of these corners and let's put him down there. If a corner gets hurt or a corner can't play, then we got to call a timeout or we can't play. I mean, there's nobody else. When you're coaching man, it's something that you instill in them, that, hey, man, nobody else on this field can do that, what we're asking you to do. And there's going to be times where, you know, they make a good play and you got to be able to move on.
At the high school level, if you're fortunate enough to have one of those cats that can cover man-to-man, he's going to be out of the corner, typically you'll go to a quarters. kind of concept. And so, you know, a safety rule in the quarters concept, be they go man on number two first. If there's no number two threat, then they, you know, zone to their quarter. Mm-hmm. If no one's in their quarter, then they'll cut, you know, or rob to number one.
Right.
And so, you know, it has a little bit of a hybrid approach, a man zone, and a lot of people are getting success with quarters. Mm-hmm. Now, going towards what we're seeing about the Super Bowl that's about to happen, you've got some big tight ends that are vertical threats at the NFL level. You see some people that are using tight ends and closed sets at the high school level and college. These things are cyclical. They come back and forth. One of the things that I've seen coaches struggle with defensively and from a secondary perspective is in the quarters coverage. You have some vulnerability there because defending a closed set, the safeties are tied to the run, and then all of a sudden, you know, you have a vertical threat. What are some things that you've thought of that and have worked for you to help safeties get better eyes or better technique? And again, I understand you're dealing with the best athletes at the collegiate level, but the coaching fundamentals, I would imagine, stay the same.
Right. Well, you know, and I coached quarters for a long time, and I would say if you cut me open, it'd be man free first and then quarter second. Because again, there's a lot of man principles there in quarters. But I think the biggest thing in coaching quarters is understanding the issues, because there are issues, just like every coverage. There are issues there and having an answer. And again, it's like boxing. You know, if you're going to play, you know, 70 snaps a game and you play 70 snaps a quarters, there's a pretty good chance that the offense is going to have a little success because they know what you're going to do, and they get, you know, if they're good coaches worth their salt, they're going to find a way to snag the safety and run the post over the top, or they're going to find a way to run scissors outside and get the corner to chase and then run away from the safety. You know, so I think a couple things that help with quarters is number one is your pre-snap alignments and having a change up. Cover two is a very good change up to quarters from the standpoint of it takes a little pressure off the safeties. From the standpoint of having to take number two vertical all the time, because again, once number two, whether it be the tight end or slot receiver, gets past linebacker depth, he's become zero man with the safety, and you know, which brings up some issues sometimes if your safety is not as good an athlete as the number two guy is covering. But I like cover two as a change up to take some of that pressure off of it a little bit and let that guy soften up and play with some depth and drive downhill on the football. Instead of, you know, matching it up and turning his back with verticals. But your pre-snap alignment, you know, you don't have to tell them, you know, that you're playing quarters. I've started my safeties off before at 14 or at between 14 and 12. And then on the snap, stepped them down to 12 if I'm starting at 14, or snap, step them down to 10 if I'm starting at 12, you know, as soon as the ball snapped, and then pop their feet. Because I wanted the quarterback to think we were in a two high before the snap, and vice versa. When I've played cover two, I've started everybody off at 10 and then run out to deep halves again, to try to control instead of being dictated to the coverage. You know, coverage wise, you either show them the same thing every snap or never show them the same thing. You know, so there's a couple different philosophies there, but I think pre-snap kind of helping yourself with your look, your pre-snap look, to kind of, you know, make the quarterback think a little bit, and changing up your coverage, you know, from, you know, four to two. You can also roll to one high, you know, out of quarters look, which is, you know, you got your safety screwed in there at 10 yards, and then all of a sudden your safety has to step down, you know, 2 or 3 yards to be on top of number two man to man, and your other guys rotating to the middle of the field. So I think to help your quarters, I think versatility and variation helps quarters. But I like playing quarters. I tell you what I really like, Jeff, is I like playing quarters with the odd front, because I've got an extra dropper, which is really good to the boundary. So now people try to attack your boundary corner, you know, and all of a sudden now he can press bail knowing that I've got an outside backer dropping. You know, I can drop eight, you know, and still play coverage over the back end, which I really like. It's very hard to throw into that, you know, so I like having that extra dropper. So actually, you know, I've done quarters and man free. Out of both four man front and three man front. The great thing about the three man front with your one high coverages and blitzes is you can drop every exotic, wacky blitz you want to do with five men, you know, and bring in different guys and still playing man free behind it.
I know you make your money on Sundays, so to speak, now being in the NFL. But take you back to Saturdays, Coach. Mm-hmm. How many defensive calls on average would you go in a Saturday with?
And that's a good question. You've got your base, and I think whatever your base is what you're really, really good at and you're most proficient at, whether that's three calls, five calls, six calls, whatever, and every defense is a little bit different. But when you get to, you know, when we would get to Thursday, we would go on, we would game plan on Sunday and Monday. Tuesday would be implementation of early downs. Wednesday would be implementation of third downs and red zone. And then by Thursday, when we look back, if there were things that we really didn't like, that wasn't part of our base, something that we either added or something that was new and we didn't like it, we just took it out. You know, so I think we would go in with a base thought of this is kind of what we do. And here are a couple things that are really good versus this team. Three or four new things. But if we got to Thursday and a couple of those things that we had put in for this team that we thought would be, but it was different than what we had done. If we didn't feel good about it on Thursday, we wouldn't carry it into the game. Be simple and fast and overcome people with the way we play and not making mistakes, then adding a bunch of new stuff. And the only way to kind of gauge that is kind of towards the end of the week. You know, you're running things. What do the kids feel comfortable with?
And I realize this is, you know, per game, per opponent, and also per staff. But walk me through kind of some of the communication that's going on in the headphones on a Saturday. What types of things as a staff are you guys looking for when the opposing offense has the ball? And then what adjustments do you make on that data? So
right.
I'm sure that everyone has a certain thing that they're assigned to watch. Mm-hmm. Kind of walk me through a little bit of that communication, how fast you guys make adjustments, what those adjustments are on, and so forth.
Things that we've done in the past is great communication from the sideline to the box. And depending on who's up there watching, I think that has a lot to do with the information that you're getting back down if you're making the call or if you're on the field. There's some coordinators that are in the box, so they kind of see everything themselves from the top. And there's a lot of guys that do it from the sideline because they want to be there with the players. They want to look in their eyes. They want to, you know, they want to convey, want to be the energy on the sideline, want to do those things. So, but there's always usually a secondary guy in the box that can kind of see the whole formation and see what's going on. And a line guy that can kind of see what's happening in between the tackles. You know, it's the power. You know, it's the power play and you know, the linebacker didn't come over, you know, with the puller, he stayed backside, the guard got up to him on the backside and we're having problems. Well, that's hard to see from the sideline, but usually there's somebody in the box, whether it be a D-line GA or a D-line coach or a linebacker coach, up there to kind of check the box, you know, and what's happening in the run fits. And then there's usually a guy that's got some, you know, that's got some kind of secondary background. And it's been part of the game week breakdown where he sees a formation and knows right now, hey, their top five concepts in the passing game out of this formation has been this. And then all of a sudden now we're charting. Did they run, you know, here's the formation. Did they run this? Or, hey, they line up in that formation. They have not hit this route. It's still coming. Or, you know what, this is a new formation we hadn't seen. They just ran this route. Let's draw that up to go over it so we can explain to our guys because it's a little bit different than what we practice for. So I think you're always – and then in the box, we're going to have somebody that's going to try to get personnel for us just because for the defensive coordinator, when we get the personnel, it kind of narrows down their calls, you know, in their mind, what they're going to call to those things. And so I think personnel, down the distance personnel, and then somebody to look at the front. And somebody helping the back end for any adjustments to formations, to see formations and routes that they're running.
So your adjustments, you know, you might tell a linebacker on his fit. You have some coaching points. You may possibly change up a strength call or something like that halfway through. But your main adjustment it comes at halftime.
Scheme-wise. So. In between series, if there's an issue, that we can get to. And you, and you've coached defense, so you know, you could make all the adjustments in between series if the offense was doing a 5 minute series and 9 plays and the clock's running. Sure. But the way college, the way football has gone, they either score really fast or it's a punt really fast. So with that being said, you're either holding adjustments until halftime or until you can get them. But you would like to try to fix things right then when they come off the field, you know? And so, and that's the short term issues. They come off the field, you know, that last series, we didn't, we got reached on the zone play. Let's talk to the nose. He got reached. And then the guard got up on the linebacker and we had an issue. So let's deal with him right then. They came out and they sent a guy in motion and, you know, we want the linebacker to stay with that guy instead of the corner bumping out to take him. And now the linebacker's on the receiver, you know, so little things like that, you want to try to handle them as soon as they come off the sideline, if you can. Bigger schematical things, man, we're having a hard time with the triple option and we have, you know, what, there's not enough time sometimes in between those series to get it all. So it's like, hey, mark that play. We've got to come back and talk about it. You know, and hopefully they don't run it this next series when we go out. But that's something that's going to come back to bite us. So mark that. Let's make sure we got the formation. Do we know what happened so that can be addressed? And then, of course, we would normally get together at halftime. The first thing we would do at halftime is come together and say, look, here, give me the hit chart. You know, what are they doing to us? Are they staying on schedule? Are they doing what we thought they would do after, you know, our breakdown of the film and our breakdown of the games the week before? No, yes, they are, or no, they're not. If they're not, what are they doing? What's our plan for that?
When we talk about the good parts and the bad parts of coaching college football, what did you like the most? What did you like the least? And then as a follow-up to that, what's some advice you would have for anyone that's listening that's thinking about a career in college coaching?
We used to joke, you know, I'd have, you know, coaches on our staff. We'd joke all the time that, you know, this is a great game, terrible profession. and I think because of college football at its highest level is entertainment. And it's to the decision makers, that's exactly what it is. And just like anything, if you're a band and you go have a concert and you've only got half the people in the stadium, that's going to, you know, in the arena, wherever you're performing, that's going to impact booking down the road. And same thing with football, right? So if you win, you pack the stands. Every person sitting in that stand has a value, a dollar value connected to it. And when there's big chunks of, and they work together, when you're winning, all of those dollar signs and those values are in those seats and they're well accounted for. When you're losing, they won't be there. And again, there's a value in those seats when they're empty. And for decision makers, that's the bottom line at the end of the day. That's the bottom line. Because college football is the front door of major universities. I've said it and I've heard it said a lot of times is, you know, having a good football team is one of the best recruiters you can have for a major university for student recruitment, you know, not just for athletes, but for students. You know, Alabama's got a great football program, and to think that Alabama's program hadn't helped, you know, get kids to want to come to be a student at Alabama would be ridiculous to think that it hadn't helped. So it's a huge, huge part of the university, huge part. But with those things being said, there's a great pressure to win. You know, one thing about college football is that it's a very unstable profession, especially for assistant coaches. And if you want to be a college football coach because you want to make a bunch of money, then good luck, right? There's because at some point it's not going to be about the money, you know. It's going to be, you know, and not every college coach is making a bunch of money out there. So you have to do it for you know, other reasons than that. And for me, luckily, I was able to have some nice jobs and you know, the pay was good. But for me, it was about a relationship with the players. And as a football coach, and that's something I struggle with a little bit now as a scout, is that football coaching was my ministry. It was my opportunity to build relationships with young people and help young men become men. The young men that I still get calls from and texts from and emails from, and you know, to see where they are now, and coach, you don't know how much of an impact you had on my life. That's priceless. You can't get that anywhere else doing anything else. And I think that's what drives coaches to be coaches, is that relationship that you can't get doing anything else. Is that when a player comes to you with, and Jeff, you'll know that look, and other coaches that are listening will know what that look is, but you've worked on something all week, and they go out and do it exactly like you told them, and something good happens. And when they come back to the sideline, that look that they give you, that excitement, you can't get that anywhere else doing anything. Matthew McConaughey is a huge UT fan. I mean, this great actor, but he's at UT football games. Why? Because even on a set, he can't get that. He's on the bench at the basketball game, because even as an actor in Hollywood, you can't get that feeling doing anything else. So that part is great about being a college football coach. Your family takes a toll. It takes a toll on your family, because of the time that has to be spent doing college football these days because of recruiting is 365 days, at least 16 hours a day, at the minimum 16 hours a day. And there's circumstances and consequences that come with being a college football coach that a lot of college football coaches fall prey to and fall into issues with. You know, there are a lot of the divorce rate for college coaches is very high, because the basis of a relationship is time and spending time with somebody. And when you're spending time as a football coach, that's time that you're not with your family. And that was something I always struggled with. And I thought that I balanced it pretty well, because when I was a football coach, even when I was home, I was on my phone recruiting. My body was there, but I was still, you know, trying to keep up with recruits and, you know, because of the instability of this job, you know, of being a college football coach, you're working as hard as you possibly can because you're dealing with something that you can't control. How can you control what an 18, 19-year-old is going to do on the football field on Saturday? Well, you can't. And at the college level, because the money is so high, because of the high profile, there's serious consequences when those 18, 19-year-olds don't do what they've been coached to do, or the team doesn't play the way they are. And that's stressful on coaches. It's stressful on families. I was fortunate to only work for three head coaches in 18 years, which is, you know, which is rare. I only coached for, well, if you count Tulsa, I guess four. But I've only worked at four universities, which is very rare if you've been coaching for 18 years. But I remember coming from Memphis to the University of Texas. And of course, from a career standpoint, you go from Memphis to University of Texas, unbelievable. But it was the first time my kids really cried about a move. And it was the first time that they, you know, it was like, I'm leaving the best friends of my life, and I'm happy, my wife's happy, and the kids are crying. Just do. I've still got tons of friends in the profession, and every year around this time, when the coaching carousel comes around, you know, I try to put out an extra little prayer for them, because I know what they're going through. It's not easy to go out and look for jobs. You know, so those are the things that's hard about coaching. The things that are great is game day, right? You can't. It's awesome. The winning is great. I do not miss losing. I miss winning. You know, I mean, I miss the feel of, you know, you've worked your butt off all week, you know, for basically to play for 60 minutes and you outlasted the other team and you did well and you win. And that celebrated locker room is an unbelievable feeling, you know, to be a part of. Whether you've lost six games in a row and you win that one for that moment, it's unbelievable, you know, and vice versa. You've won five in a row and then you lose one. And it's like, you know, just, you know, it's heartbreaking. So, you know, that part, you know, I missed that celebrated locker room. I missed the camaraderie with coaches, you know, and just that bond that you have with them because they're going through the same thing that you're going through. And just being part of a team. I think that's, you know, if you're a football guy, being a part of a team is important.
The Cowboys have this coach that's got 18 years of experience coaching D1 football. And you are really able to see talent and understand how that talent is going to fit into a desired scheme or fit into a desired plan. What are some commonalities there, though, that the high school coach, the college coach, and the NFL scout can all look to as far as things that when they're evaluating talent?
Right. Well, you know, for the most part, it's relative, right? So, you know, if I'm scouting, when I was a college coach and I was scouting a running back, for instance, if he didn't break long runs in high school, he's not going to break them in college. Well, in college, now that I'm evaluating college guys, if he don't break long runs in college, he's not going to do it in the NFL. So there's some connection and there's some things that are really relative when you're evaluating talent. I think you have to take into consideration sometimes the level of competition, whether it be a guy that's at a small school and trying to project him to the NFL or a guy that's at a small high school trying to project him to college football. But, you know, we use a lot of analytics, which, you know, we probably use more in the NFL than we did in college. And for instance, you know, it's hard for a 6 foot, 290 pound guard to play major college football, offensive guard to play mop. Now, is it possible? Maybe. Has it happened very much, a guy that size be successful? No. If it was, there'd be a lot more of them that did it. It's easy, the guy that has all the measurables. You know, he's an offensive tackle. He's 6'6", you know, 315. He's got 34, 35-inch arms. He's athletic. Those are a little easier to project. Well, you've got a guy that's not 6'6". He's 6'5". He's got 33-inch arms, and he weighs 305. Can this guy make it? Well, what are the intangibles? What kind of work ethic does this guy have? Is he smarter than everybody? You know, if he's missing those things and he's not smart and he's not a great worker, well, that tells you too. So there's some variables in there with intangibles that, you know, that you have to sell sometime to say, okay, this guy can get it done this way. When you go against the norm as far as height, weight, and speed traits, you have to ask yourself, what makes this guy different than history? You know, for the longest time, offense tackles had to have at least 33.5-inch arms in the NFL. Okay, so all of a sudden you come with this offense tackle that you really, really like, and he's got 32.5. Okay, well, now you have to say, okay, well, not saying this guy won't make it, but what makes him different than what history has told us? And then I guess on the ones that work out, you kind of poke your chest out a little bit.
As the evaluator of the talent, let's talk about the evaluatee. What mistakes have you seen from the kids' perspectives, either from the transition of high school to college or college to the pros?
Well, I think the biggest thing is, or one of the biggest things, especially now, is social media. Because whether it is really them or not, perception is reality. I think, you know, that they've got to be very, very smart with what they do. Now, it's also a huge tool for them to really show coaches who they are. You know, so again, there's a responsibility that comes with that. You know, the guy that's posting his workouts every day, you know, stuff he's doing in the community, Well, that's a great way to use social media to promote your brand and promote yourself for coaches to see, because coaches are always trying to find out, you know, more about the young man that they're trying to invest in. And we do it at the NFL level too. We want to know what this guy's about, you know, and where you put your time is usually where, you know, kind of where your heart lies. So if this guy's always partying and having a good time and you don't see him in the, you know, training and working, well, that's probably who he is. Build their brand is huge during this process. And when you're evaluating them, because again, you are what you're projecting, you know, and when you're being evaluated, you always want to put your best foot forward, and they just need to know that this is a big tool that's being used and they're being viewed, and it carries over into life, you know. Business recruiters that are trying to recruit guys for jobs in the business world are looking at social media, you know, to see what is this guy into or what is this guy or this girl's about. So I think that's a huge thing for them to be cognizant of and to work on.
Let's talk about one of these kids that's in this process specifically right now. The child's name is Deuce Vaughn. He is a running back in 6A football in Texas, which is the highest classification of football in the state of Texas. In talking to a coach that coached against this running back this year, he said he's one of the best running backs he's ever coached against, and he's a defensive-minded head coach, and was very, very high on the game-changing ability of this young man. Deuce Vaughn happens to have the same last name as you because you happen to be his father. What I want to talk about is this is kind of, you mentioned about being at home and you know, you missed some stuff with your family being a coach and kind of sacrifice some of that maybe. Now you get a chance to be the kind of the proud papa in the stands. He's been receiving a lot of offers from some D1 schools. Walk me through what's going on with you right now and how that looks and that different perspective of not being the recruiter, but right, being the guy that's maybe being introduced to recruiters and talking to them from the parent perspective.
Well, the thing that's funny is I decipher everything now. So, you know, a coach comes by the school to see him. I say, well, listen, what did he say? What did he tell you? All right. So in the back of my mind, I kind of know where he is. So, you know, I've got a pecking order, you know, kind of in my mind based on, you know, what coach, because I've said it all, I've done it all. So when a guy says something, like, okay, I know what that means right there. Or, hey, you know, this means that, or, you know, man, we need to go check these guys out because they're serious, or that coach ain't very serious. He likes you, but he don't like you that much. You know, so it's interesting kind of seeing from the other side how things work. And you know, so one thing that he will have an advantage of is, you know, there will not be any wool pulled over any eyes. And what's funny about recruiting is, you know, recruiting is hard, and it's hard to how do I phrase this? You're juggling a lot of things, and you hadn't gotten married yet, but you're dating a lot of girls. You're dating a lot of girls, and you're trying to find, it's like The Bachelor. You're dating a lot of girls and you're trying to find the one, and you've got to, you know, you've got to hold on to a couple. I don't want to use the word string along, but you've got to hold on to a couple as you kind of find out what your kind of cream of the crop thinks about you. And so it's a balancing act, and it's one that's unavoidable, because you can't, if you need three receivers, you can't offer three receivers because everybody else is recruiting to you. If that's all you do, you're going to end up with two receivers, or you're going to end up with one receiver. So to do that, there's a balancing act there, you know? So I know how recruiting works. So again, I'm always trying to, you know, kind of read between the lines and see things here and see what the coach is thinking here. And so just trying to educate him on those things and trying to, trying to navigate it, you know, from having some insider information. You don't have, you know, it's great to have 50 offers and 30 offers and 20, but really and truly, all you can only sign one. So whether you have one offer or 30, you know, it's just find that one team that believes in you and fits your skill set big time is wherever you are. You know, I think kids get caught up sometime and, you know, well, I've got to be at University of Texas, or I've got to be at A&M, or I've got to be at Florida State, or I've got to be at Georgia. Well, big time is wherever you are. You know, I was fortunate to have a successful coaching career, and I went to Murray State, Little Murray State in Kentucky. I met my wife there. So ultimately my kids were, because I went to Little Murray State, met some of my best friends I've ever had in my life there. And big time was where we were, you know. So for the recruits out there and you know, and coaches that were talking to recruits that, you know, maybe they have their eyes set on, you know, going to school A, but their opportunities are really at school B or school C. There's nothing wrong with that. If you love football, and that's a big part of if you love football, you know, if you love what football brings to you, if you love the thought of football, then you say, well, you know what, you know, that school is just that one. You know, I'd rather not. But if you love football, you'll go play anywhere to go get a free education, go play football.
So let's pretend that the state of Texas passes a very unusual law.
Okay.
And the unusual law says that you have to have a bumper sticker permanently affixed to your vehicle. And this bumper sticker goes with you wherever you go. And if you change your vehicle, it's applied to the new vehicle. What does the bumper sticker that's permanently affixed to Coach Vaughn's vehicle say?
And this is sports affiliate or a life affiliate?
It doesn't matter.
Does not matter.
Yeah. You're at the DMV. You've got a line people behind you, and they're going, okay, come on. What's this bumper sticker going to say? So it can be whatever your philosophy is and in whatever area you want to take it, Coach.
It would be live the code. And the philosophy behind that is, when I was a GA at Arkansas, our defensive coordinator, name is Keith Burns. He's currently secondary coach at UTEP. Been the head coach at Tulsa. He was actually the one that gave my first coaching job at Tulsa, even though I wasn't there long. I coached his son at Ole Miss, which is crazy. And we worked together as coaches together at Ole Miss. And I just love his family, and my wife and his wife are close and those things. But when I was a GA there, the thing that he did, he had a great impact on me and as a coach. And the thing that he did that was unbelievable is he could get guys to believe. You know, when I was telling you about that one call that we had, well, he was the defensive coordinator. And again, it was just a bare front, send the wheel through the A gap. We're bringing pressure off the edge. We're playing zero coverage. And it was like, he would start the game off with that call, like for like six games in a row, same call, tackle for loss, first play. And the offense knew the call was coming, but the players believed in it so much. So, you know, we had a code, and that's what we talk about. It was code red. Then we're at Arkansas. It was code red. And that was be prepared, play hard, max speed, and finish. And those four things, as a coach, I've always carried. I've never forgot it. That was 18 years ago. I can repeat those things back without thinking, okay, I don't have to go, okay, code, what's the code? I know it like it's a language, because of the belief that we had and the way he sold it. And he sold it to me 18 years ago as a GA. And to this day, I still know it. And my former players can tell you the code. But I think that applies to life. You know, be prepared. Well, anything you have coming up, whether it be an interview, whether it be a speaking engagement, whether it be a date, be prepared. So and then play hard. You know, work, play hard. You can replace play hard with work hard in everything you do. And then there's max speed, which to me, max speed is on the football field is one thing, but in life, it's not procrastinating, getting things done, knocking things out. I'm a list guy. If I have something on my list to do today, if I don't get it done, I'm out of whack. So I'm big into that. And that's kind of what, for me, what max speed is. And then finish, whatever you start, finish. So those four things that started off being just a football, you know, code and a football thing to work towards has carried over into my life. And that's one thing that I always sold to my players, is that this will carry over into your life as you go. So I guess, you know, live the code would be the sticker that would be on my car.
Be prepared, play hard, max speed, and finish.
Yep.
It's awesome. Coach, I really appreciate you taking the time to speak with me on Holding the Edge. You are a coach that is based in principle. I've had the pleasure of having many conversations with you about coaching, about life, about faith, about kids. And I'm honored that you're giving me a couple minutes on here. I'm not a Cowboys fan, but now ever since you belong to the Cowboys organization, I find myself secretly rooting for them because I root for you. You can follow Coach Vaughn on Twitter at @CoachVaughn_DBs, as in defensive backs. That's @CoachVaughn_DBs. And also watch the progress of Deuce as he goes through the rest of the recruiting process in this next year of high school football. Coach, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with me.
Thank you, my friend. Appreciate you having me on.
Thank you for listening to Holding the Edge. Our goal is to provide multiple coaches' perspectives at tackling challenges you see in your own program. If you are interested in being featured in a future podcast, please email info@defensivecoordinator1.com. Thank you for all you do to advance this game and change young men's lives.